Let's adjust the clock a bit. Yeah, pixel perfect EGA awesomeness. Hi everyone and welcome. This is a follow-up video on the MCE Blaster, a Pico-based MDA, CGA and EGA to VGA adapter. In the previous video, I gave an overview of how TTL and VGA video works, and the basics of what the adapter should do and how it works. I showed a working prototype, which had some display issues, the main one being the sampling artifacts, which showed us these repeating vertical and noisy bars. So let me take a step back and try to explain what is going on here. Even though the video signal coming out of an MDA, CGA or EGA card is a digital TTL compatible signal, it is actually meant to be used by an analog CRT display. CRT displays are completely analog devices and they have no notion of pixels. This means that they will display whatever pixels they receive, but can't actually tell pixels apart. This is because, unlike LCD displays, CRTs do not need to place the pixels at an exact dedicated position on the display surface. Pixels can be placed practically anywhere and the display will still work great. So a pixel could be drawn here, but it could also be drawn here and it would still look fine. To understand what is going on in more detail, I would highly recommend watching the 8-bit guy's awesome video on how CRTs work. Anyway, the reason for this discussion is to give you some insights into why processing the TTL signal digitally is not super easy. The video signal carries the pixels over time, and the pixel values change according to the video card's pixel clock. For most EGA cards, this is at 16.257 MHz, meaning that we get a new pixel value every 61.511 nanoseconds. If the signal were to be consumed by a digital display, one would expect that the pixel clock would also be passed along with the video to the display to help the display read the pixel data. But since the CRT display is analog, and the pixels are just drawn on screen one next to the other, without the need for precise placement, there's no need for such clock signal. This is probably why there is no pixel clock in the TTL video signal. But the adapter is digital, so it needs to precisely sample each pixel, and therefore it needs to recreate the pixel clock internally and use it for sampling the pixels. If the sampling clock is either slower or faster, then there are these repeating sections where sampling happens during the transition of the pixel value, which sometimes returns the previous pixel and sometimes the next. This is visible as noise in the output and is the actual cause of the noisy vertical bars that I showed in the previous video. So the solution is to make sure that the Pico samples the input at the exact frequency and we are done. Well, this is not as easy as it sounds. Here is why. Sampling is done with the Pico's PIO state machines by reading the GPIO values in a loop. So the sampling period is the latency of the sampling loop body. At 270 MHz, each PIO instruction takes 3.703 nanoseconds to execute. As mentioned earlier, our target sampling period is 61.511 nanoseconds. So here is where the problem is. Dividing 61.511 nanoseconds by 3.703 nanoseconds gives us 16.611, which is not an integer. So we can't create a loop that takes exactly 61.511 nanoseconds by just padding with no op delays. But luckily, the Pico's PIOs have some clock divider circuitry. So if we write a 16 instruction sampling loop that takes 59.248 nanoseconds, then we need a clock divider of 1.038. Well, the problem is that the PIO clock divider's fractional part has an 8-bit resolution. That is, it can only divide with a granularity of about 0.004. So in our case, the divider won't be 1.038, but instead 1.035 or 1.039. But is this error a big deal? If we use a 1.035 clock divider, then our sampling pixel period is going to be 61.322 nanoseconds, so there is an error of 0.189 nanoseconds, which over 800 pixels is about 151 nanoseconds, which is more than 2 pixel periods, which is definitely too much. If instead we use a 1.039 clock divider, then our sampling pixel period is going to be 61.558 nanoseconds, so there is an error of 0.047 nanoseconds, which over 800 pixels is about 37 nanoseconds, which is about 60% of a pixel period, which may be acceptable. If we can't get a good clock divider, we can also try loops with different latencies like 15, 14, 13 and so on, and look for the one with the lowest error. This is exactly what we do in the MCE Blaster firmware to minimize the clock divider error and eliminate the sampling artifacts. Okay, now let's take a look at the actual device itself. This prototype PCB is based on an earlier design, which is where you're going to see some bodge wires and the second switch added in. But anyway, let's put it together. I placed the VGA connector on the opposite side to make room for the Pico's USB, which can be used for powering the adapter. Let's try it out with my Everex EGA card. This card's pixel clock for the EGA 640x350 mode is at 16.257 MHz, which is the default frequency used by the adapter, so we're getting no sampling artifacts in this mode. In 320x200, however, we need to adjust the sampling frequency a bit using the buttons. Yeah, the noise bars are completely gone and the picture looks pretty much perfect. Please note that the MCE Blaster handles 320x200 and 640x200 the same way, which is why the on-screen display shows 640x200. And yeah, all video tests in Check It look great! Let's try Prehistorik. This game also looks perfect. Prince of Persia looks great in 16 color EGA mode. Let's try 4-color CGA. Now let's try monochrome Hercules mode with this Business Land card. This card's pixel clock does not seem to match the 16.257 MHz default, so let's try to fix it. We press the pixel clock button and we can use either button to increase or decrease the clock. And as you can see, the sampling artifacts start going away as we approach the card's pixel clock. There's still some artifacts on the right hand side of the screen that we can't get rid of, so I guess that'll do. We save the settings to flash with a long push of the pixel clock button. Now let's try out another Hercules compatible card. This one has a crystal with a 16.000 marking. So my guess is that this card has a 16 MHz pixel clock. And yeah, it is very noisy at the default sampling frequency. Let's reduce it to 16.000 MHz. And yeah, we get a perfect noise-free picture, better than what we got with the other card. Okay, that's all for now. The sources and the Gerber files for the MCE Blaster can be found on the project's page on GitHub. This project uses very few components. Perhaps it's worth designing a version with through-hole parts for easier assembly. Please let me know your opinion in the comments. I hope you enjoyed the video, and as always, thanks for watching and goodbye.